What are the fractals? Anyone knows? Anyone can tell us what is a fractal? What are the characteristics of a fractal?
Okay. Infinity.
Good. One characteristic is infinity. But fractals are geometric shapes that are self-replicating. They're self-replicating and they are self-similar. So for instance, so for instance, you know the cauliflower? You do? Good. So, what the cauliflower, you know, have you noticed how every tiny floret of the cauliflower is like the whole cauliflower head? Yeah? So if you zoom into it, of course, if it's not, every tiny flower is like the whole head. So it's made of pieces that are like the whole. So the whole and the part are the same thing.
There's one that's better, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, also, exactly, what is called?
Cavolo, C-A-V-O-L-O.
C-A-V?
V-O.
O-L-O.
L-O. R-O.
Is it Cavolo Nero?
No.
Okay. C-A-V-O-L-O?
Romano. R-O-M-A-N-O.
Let's see.
Is it the pointy one?
Is this one, like?
Yeah, the pointy one.
I didn't manage to do it.
Crazy one at my house.
Cavolo Romano?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but somehow I don't have any images. Finding it in somehow in the everyday. Broccoli is like that. Fern leaves are like that. Fern leaves are like that. Yeah? But not only broccoli and fern. Snowflakes are like that. Yes?
Shells?
Shells are like that. But it's almost possible to say that this fractal geometry is very much everywhere in the world. We're just not used to looking at it.
It's the most present in nature.
It's the most present in nature, yeah. We don't build our houses like fractals, but let's say snails do. Yeah, now, that's why I thought we can go to YouTube and as we look at this clip, I want you to to realize that you are looking at fractals, that every steel here is a fractal. Can you see the waves, the clouds? Oh. Perfect. So, why we are talking about fractals? Well, Benoit Mandelbrot developed this fractal geometry in the mid 20th century by following some quite neglected mathematical discoveries that for many hundreds of years were considered somehow an aberration, a sort of monstrosity. Yeah? But some people who contributed to thinking about fractals in the past shouldn't be forgotten. One of them is Giordano Bruno. Maria, that's your book on Bruno?
Yeah.
Yeah. So so he in his monads that Giordano Bruno was fascinated with, you can see the fractal geometry. And I think Maria has a book with some of Bruno's images, not here. But then the German mathematician Leibniz developed some understanding of fractals and even demonstrated a way of creating a fractal, which we probably could do if we have a piece of paper and a pen. I can show you how a very simple fractal can be drawn. Here we go. But it will be quite crude. So let's say you start with a triangle, yeah? Then what you do, you select the middle part of one of the sides, yeah? And erect a triangle on that point. So then you get something like that, and you repeat it for the others. Okay, now of course if I could I would remove these lines in between. So now you get what is known as the Star of David. Okay, then you take each one of the sides, again divide it into three, and erect a triangle in its place. Then you repeat and repeat, and of course very soon it becomes impossible to draw because it just gets so tiny. Yeah, but if you look at the structure of a typical snowflake, you will see something very similar. Now if we there's a nice images of fractals in the on the Wikipedia page. Yeah, here it is. You can kind of see why people didn't really get engaged with fractals before the advance of computers, because it's incredibly difficult to draw something like that. But what happens if you keep subdividing the triangle into these thirds? Yeah, so that's called the core snowflake. The other. You can use vectors, yeah, but because this is just a very simple example of what is a fractal. But the most classic examples of fractals are these Mandelbrot sets. That this is a shape that you're familiar with, yeah? You saw that. I will find one of the moving one.
I think there's endless high definition videos on YouTube.
Well, it was just not working very well, the YouTube, but absolutely, I should again.
Yeah.
Which one? The favorite one?
Mm-hmm. No, but I think high definition. Probably YouTube is kind of
yeah. No, but this is, that seems to me something else.
I think they're called Julia set.
Yes, yes, Julia set. But here, this one, yeah. But this is actually a very good, this is a very good program, BBC program about fractals, which are really interesting to watch, actually. We're not going to do it now, but, because I want to get to some points that, let's look at Julius. So do you see, at any point, kind of, you will not be able to tell whether you are at the end or the beginning. There is no end or beginning. There is just continuous reflection. If you've ever been in an elevator with mirrors on both sides, for instance, that keep reflecting, that's, in a sense, a kind of a fractal self-replication.
Is it like the Stargate effect?
What is the Stargate effect?
Space Odyssey, for example, when there's the light shifting next to you.
I'm not sure, because I'm not entirely sure what the Stargate effect is. If someone can someone explain? Let's start talking about it from slightly different dimension. In one of his earliest publications about fractals, Mandelbrot, it's an essay Mandelbrot published in the 50s, and it's called simply, How Long is the Coast of Britain? And in this essay he says, okay, so here we have... Correct.
The essay is called...
This is called How Long is the Coast of Britain? So here you have, for instance, the map of the coast of Britain. Yeah? And the essay is in the book. So he was asking a simple question. How can we know the length of, let's say, the British coastline? Because if, let's say, you use a 1 meter yardstick to measure, then you will get a certain result. But if you will use a 1 centimeter yardstick, then you will be able to get into much smaller crevices. Yeah? And you will have a different measurement. So it seems that there is no answer to this question, how long is the coast of Britain? It is completely measurement dependent. Is that what you were saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Because the coast of Britain is not made of straight lines. It is all made of, shapes like that. And where is the coast then anyway? Is it here? Is it here? Is it here? Is it here? But wherever you look, as you see, the coast is not made, annoyingly, of straight lines that you could just apply your ruler to. It is all made of these repeating curves. Now, how are you going to measure all these curves? So you will need to somehow approximate them to your ruler. And therefore, this essay is this essay is in his book. So that suggests that the coastline needs another approach to measurement, not linear, not Euclidean. In fact, the right way to look at the coast of Britain is that it is a fractal.
Not only the coast of Britain.
Not only. Of course not only, no, just an example. It's just an example, but because he took something so, it was designed to be provocative. Yeah, but of course, all coasts are like that. Not only coasts, all natural shapes are like that. They are not, well, nature did not build the world according to our measurement system. We came with our rulers, compasses, straight angles, and guess what? There's nothing in nature which is straight, has 90 degree angles. So we keep sort of trying to fit the world into our system of measurement. And what Mandelbrot is saying, well, look, guys, this is simply not working. You need to have another theory, you need to have another geometry that will not be based on how you think, because you think, for instance, in straight lines, but it will be based on the way the world is really is. And the world is made of curves, and not only of curves, but of self-repeating shapes. So, the reason it gets interesting is because the fractal has, in a sense, two aspects to it. It is a very interesting mathematical phenomenon, but it has a kind of really philosophical proposition to us, which says, stop trying to understand the world rationally. Stop trying to comprehend it through your Euclidean geometry. You could approach it from a slightly different perspective. Let's look at this thing, which we didn't do already many times. Let's look at this thing. So, Okay, let's look at this. Now, what do we see? What do I see when I look at it? Well, I will describe it as a cylinder, as green, or something like that, yeah? Okay, but the reason I can describe it like that, it's not because it is objectively a cylinder and it is objectively green. That's what Mandelbrot tries to make us understand. The way I perceive it right now is purely due to the distance and the relationship I have with this thing. Let's say that I'm looking at it from 10 kilometers away. Then I might not see anything. Then I might say there is nothing there. And if, let's say, I equip myself with very powerful binoculars, I might say, well, there is nothing there, but if I look really, really hard, I see a tiny, tiny speck, a tiny dot. So maybe what this is a dot. Then I move closer, I move to, let's say, 100 meters away, and I look again, and now I don't see a dot, I see something like a little line. So then this thing is a line. I move 10 meters away, and then I perhaps see it as a kind of shape. But I need to move a little closer to be able to see it as three-dimensional shape. Okay, but what happens if I move even closer? What happens if I move, let's say, 2 millimeters away from this thing? Then I don't really see the cylinder anymore. I just see a kind of green field. Yeah, we still talk about the same thing. Now, what happens if I move inside it? You know, then I find myself between atoms that make this structure, and between them, vast amounts of empty space. So actually, we are back to nothing. We are back to the kind of empty space. Yes?
There's that Charles and Ray Eames film of them zooming in and out of, I forget what it's called.
That's right, I also forgot what it's called, but I thought it would be nice to look at it. Sorry?
She is small and big.
Who is that?
Alice
in Wonderland. Very good, we will come back, we'll come to that today.
Powers of 10.
Yes. Powers of 10 is a great little documentary. Just make a note of it, Powers of 10 from 1997. looking at yourself, but it is, it's dealing with these kind of questions. Suggest that how we normally use language, how we normally describe things, is very much dependent on the human perspective, on the human experience of things we bring to the discussion. So it's not what the thing really is. Yeah? There is something in the book that I wanted to show you as well. I thought we had Mandelbrot here. Do you have the book?
Yeah.
You do? Did you find it on Dropbox?
Found it online. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Are you looking for the Fractals book?
Yes.
I just sent it.
To me?
Yeah. It's on OneDrive because it's like too big to...
Ah, great. I got it now. Thank you. So on page 3, he says something very interesting. He says, I think I have a different edition here. very different edition from mine. Let me just read to you what it says, even though it is not ideal. Do you all have this version? You're right. But maybe it just was not there. Marianne, you're a genius. Okay. So we are on page 3. Yeah, I guess you didn't find it. Look at that. Can someone read to us from historically just this part?
Could you make it bigger?
I will try. Can someone read that to us?
What page?
Page 3.
16 on the PDF.
16?
On the
PDF. Yes, correct. Can you read it? Or is it too far? Can someone read it first? Yes.
Historically, the revolution was forced by the discovery of mathematical structures that did not fit the patterns of Euclid and Newton. These new structures were regarded as pathological, as a gallery of monsters, akin to the cubist painting and atonal music that were upsetting established standards of taste in the arts at about the same time.
So this is interesting. This fractal geometry, this early discovery of fractal geometry, Mandelbrot is saying about it, it was considered like the sort of modernist art or atonal music, like something monstrous. Now, why is that? It is because, why do you think that is?
It doesn't define definitions, so it allows more comprehensive difference within one word. It looks like to me a little bit as they use a different concept of differences.
Okay, you're jumping ahead a little bit, but I think you're right.
It's something we're not used to. We're trying to measure everything, and you can't really. It's very difficult to measure.
Ben?
I was just gonna say the same thing. It defeats rationality.
Okay, sorry. I thought you waved your pen.
Yeah, no. I mean, I was thinking that sort of along the same lines. It defeats like our understood rationale, like what we've been taught from birth. To try and put like a unit on everything, and there's no units to sort of like cubism and these other types of things. For instance, like this drawing of the stave would be like the lines that went everywhere.
Yeah.
It's trying to sort of put something inside of like a unit system that just doesn't work.
That's right, and at the same time, it's like, as you were saying, it is. Kind of imprecise geometry, or in a sense, it just puts precision as only one dimension through which reality can be experienced.
Could I have my speakers back?
Yes.
And could I show you something I wanted to show you?
Would you like to pass it? Yeah.
And this idea of evolution, we have spent like centuries and centuries of trying to sort this out.
Yeah.
And then suddenly comes and breaks the idea that it actually works.
terms of Mandelbrot.
Oh, no, in terms of this idea of evolution,
yes.
Finding the stabilization within the SDF working system of logic.
Well, yeah, because it seems this fractal geometry seems to contradict the way we understand logic. But yet, it seems to explain very well other things which are not even, in a sense, it allows us to look at the world in a slightly different way, even if we look at things we are familiar with. So for instance, you know Hookaside, the painter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so in this very famous, this very famous painting of the waves, yeah? When we look at it through Mandelbrot's fractal, can you see? It's actually a fractal. It's actually a fractal because it seems that once you start looking at the world fractally, and let's say at your practice fractally, you start noticing something else. For instance, Irene, your install on Monday, was it a fractal?
Yeah,
it was a fractal, and it was clear to you. That's how you
now,
made it.
Yeah,
now it's clear. Okay. Well, but you see, and that's why actually I think the red ball, you didn't need it there, because in the fractal, you don't need to make this kind of statement. It's all about self-replication. Yeah?
If we are talking about replication just as a replication itself, yes, of course, but if it was not just about replication, it was...
Yeah.
But I understand.
Well, the point is that you started to work in this install with a certain energy that you could call it the fractal energy. So some of the power of the work became associated not so much with the opposition between the one and the many, like in, for instance, Leni Riefenstahl's film, where there is the Führer and the masses. So you have the red ball and the white balls. And the opposition is very clear. The politics, you know, the antagonism, you know, the one and the many, the different. But then there is another logic that appears there and starts to also work. And this is not the logic of either or, not the logic of one and the many, not the logic of identity and difference, but logic of continuous self-replication, in which the questions of identity or difference don't apply really, because each one, let's say if these are your goals, yeah? Each one is self-identical to all the others, and it is both, each one is both the macrocosm and the microcosm of the whole picture. Yeah? So you can kind of look at it like that, or you can look at it like that, you can look at it like that, and you all the time see the same thing. You know, it could be that this shape is exactly repeated in this shape. And if you zoom in, you, in theory at least, might be able to see that this shape itself is constructed from loads and loads of these kind of shapes, just like that does. Yeah? So in this kind of image, and in the image that makes use, one second, that image that makes use of fractal energies or fractal powers, there's no point asking, is it big or is it small? So what is bigger? Is this bigger than this? In a fractal logic, it doesn't make sense to ask. You need to ask another question, because this could also be a tiny element of a much bigger picture if you zoom out. Yeah? And if you zoom in, that might become as intricately developed and detailed as this painting. Yeah. Now it's just interesting. And one second, Julie. Just interesting that if you look, for instance, at Aboriginal art, or at Arabic Muslim art, like the arabesque, it seems that, or even at Baroque music, and even I think at electropop, that was I was trying to play with this double, it seems that many artists are interested in fractals and work with them in various ways. Julie, now you can finally say
it's funny because I have a musical response for that. It's 30 seconds long.
Fine.
There is no simple definition of the first
played to us now was monstrous?
Yeah.
What is a monster? What is a monster? Who is a monster here?
But
are there monsters?
So
are you a monster? I thought so. I always knew that about you. Well, welcome to the company of monsters. But monster, I think it's a very interesting word. It's also somehow relates to demonstrating. Demonstrate and the monstrosity. Monstrosity is demonstrative. Yeah? So there is something monstrous in making a demonstration of yourself, in making an exhibition of yourself.
Is it something about symmetry and asymmetry? The fractal that might relate to that.
Fractals are very symmetrical, that's right.
But yeah, they break away and
yeah.
Become asymmetrical.
Well, they have quite complex symmetries. I mean, these are all fractals. And by the way, just so you know, fractals are also extensively used in CGI. So, for instance, if you ever played Flight Simulator, or if you ever looked at a computer game where the landscape is being generated as you zoom in, let's say if you are playing a driving game or a flying game, and let's say you fly through some canyon, and then as you move closer, you know, the mountains acquire more detail and more shape. That is all done through fractal geometry, because that allows you to build these shapes on the fly very quickly with very small amount of resources. You don't need to have you don't need to have high resolution footage, let's say, of the mountains. All you need is to realize that mountains are all made of polygons, and you just have a fractal formula that rebuilds these polygons all the time, right?
This is actually like very recently done for the first time. Like, obviously there's been forms of it which have been used for video games, but for the first time there was this British video game company who announced like a game that uses this method to build the entire universe infinitely.
Right.
So
and
Wait a second, but let Ben finish.
So the video game basically uses a mathematical formula to build planets, and then as well as build planets, it also builds like organic like structures, so that basically there's new creatures, and you can basically play this game forever, and you will never get to the end of it. And so a lot of people got really excited about it. And
what is the name?
It's called Life.
No, the name of the game is called No Man's Sky. And yeah, apparently, like after these guys like created this engine, which basically builds a universe infinitely, like all the other game designers were like, "Shit, what have we been doing with our time?"
But also, it's I think there is a kind of parallel with philosophy, because the fractal cannot be you cannot arrive to the origin of the fractal in a spiral. You cannot touch the point in a spiral. You can always just see the point, but never arrive. I mean, the fractal cannot be saved. If we zoom and zoom and zoom, there will be always an infinite
yes.
shape.
Yes.
In philosophy, the substance is always looking around, but no one arrived to define this being, the present, and as we want to call God, blah blah blah.
So, I think. Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, there is a kind of parallelism with this concept and the universe.
There is a parallel with philosophy. You're absolutely right. Johnny Golding, who was my PhD supervisor, and she is one of the most remarkable contemporary philosophers, she came up with this notion, fractal philosophy. She developed it as a concept. And I think by that she means it's a philosophy that does not start from a system. It doesn't start from, instance, like Euclidean geometry starts from some axioms. It's not a philosophy that starts from some ideas. It's a philosophy that progresses by self-replication, where repetition and self-replication and similarities are more important than starting point. It's a philosophy that, in a sense, makes room for desire, for feelings, for sensations, for intuition, for messy, kind of dirty, sensual bits. So, while I think the question of substance is an interesting one, what I sort of want to think with you a little bit about is, first, what is the connection then between fractals and visual art? And beyond the simple notion that fractals are kind of beautiful things to put in t-shirts, what fractals really mean in terms of fine art? Where in fine art we see people being inspired or influenced by fractal thinking? Or how can we make something like that engage with our practice? Do you think the web is fractal? The web is fractal?
The network?
Yes, the network, the web, there are different things, but broadly speaking, the internet.
Yeah.
Is it fractal?
Yeah.
Why? Why?
It's replicating itself.
It's self-replicating. It's good, yeah. It has no center. And it has a kind of strange self-symmetry.
Who?
The art academia is fractal. How?
Because like in different parts, like you have the same text on the same stuff, the same movements that emerge like over the world.
That's a good point. Yeah, that probably there are many, many, many classrooms where the same text is read. And yeah, so there is a kind of similarity that also creates some kind of difference.
At a different time, like, so we can kind of track it again at scale.
Okay, good, interesting. Now, before I want to talk to you a little bit about how fractals relate to photography specifically and to your practice. But before we do that, what I think is really interesting is how fractals relate to artificial intelligence. We spoke about it last week when we spoke about the post-human. We spoke about the artificial intelligence of the Cartesian model. But the main principle of the fractal is self-replication. Yeah? Now, to self-replicate, all you really need is an initial state of matter that can be even chaos. Yeah? Now, what then happens if you have a leaf, an environment, any kind of environment that has certain obstacles, that has, well, just, you know, a world. You imagine a world in which there is an initial state and this fractal principle of self-replication keeps repeating what was already there, taking it and copying it, taking it and making another generation, another generation. Then, of course, the natural selection kicks in as well. So out of all these self-replicated new generations, some will survive, some will not. So in a sense, that's all you need in order to explain intelligent life. All you need is this fractal self-replication and natural selection. That's exactly how, this is the basic principle behind computer learning. There are two ways to build an intelligent robot. One is to load it, to preload it with all the necessary information. The other is to build, let's say, through various sensors to allow it to learn about its environment as it goes along. Yeah, so for instance, if the robot bumps into a corner, the next time it will learn how to go around it. Yeah, so it's not like it already has inbuilt knowledge of corners, but it just has this ability to reflect on something that happened. So that's exactly what happens when the robot, artificial intelligence, is designed through fractals. There was a very good video on YouTube that I didn't find last time about the way kind of a computer generated robot, like basically a stick, learns how to walk and go over obstacles. I might be able to find it now. These are lectures, but there was a very nice experiment.
I think it's a robot teaches itself how to walk.
Can you find it?
Yeah, it's a long video.
Oh yeah, that's what we saw last
time. Or there's,
year.
No, Starfish Self-Modeling Robot. I think that's what it is.
Starfish?
Yeah. Did it look like that?
Is it this? The top one?
No. It's by Bot Junkie. It's the user.
But I think that.
Or a TV.
That's
the world is thinking.
That's the one that's.
Now, this robot
needs
to learn a measure this kind of border balance. So it begins by babbling, just moving the border in a random way. And then it sends, collects all the sensory information, and then it forms hypotheses about what it might be. And what you can see on the top left. All the hypothesis, what it looks like. Now, with that self model,
they
you
talk
know,
a lot.
Let the robot...
But there is another video of this exact robot really learning how to walk.
Yeah, it is. It's called Starfish Self Modeling Robot.
Yeah. Okay. I hope you. I hope you get some idea of what we are talking about here. There are some clearer examples available, but the whole point is that it is this self-referential feedback loop that teaches this robot to walk. It was not given a walking program, but it just keeps refeeding back, and it is this fractal logic that, in a sense, allows robots to learn. Yeah, so this is key to artificial intelligence, and I think key, you can say probably, key to intelligence in general, because this is the one element that we tend to disregard or maybe ignore when we talk about intelligence, and that is the notion of this self-replication. Now, what I would like to talk to you about is how self-replication is really working in photography. So for instance, when we looked at Van Gogh at the painting of the sunflower, yeah? So you could see the self-replication there. You could see that it is basically the same stroke that is repeating itself again and again and again. How does it stand with the photographic image? Where is the photographic image fractal?
The pixel,
how?
Because if it's on the image, you can see the pixel.
Right.
In digitally.
Okay. And how is that each?
Analogically, there are like this, I'm writing in English, okay, the pieces of, anyway, the chemicals.
The molecules, yeah. Yeah, the silver halides.
Yes. So, maybe also analogical.
Okay, this is good, but I think we can approach the fractality of photography in a slightly different way. Do you want to have a break?
Yeah.
Ooh, okay. 6 pistols say learn 3 chords and form a band. In a sense, they say work fractally. Here are 3 chords. You're not going to just play 1, 2, 3 and over. You're going to repeat them, and this repetition will create the music. Yeah? That is fractal. Now, this is another example of the way this fractal works. And, you know, this is such a cliche. It's such a cliche piece of music, but again, it is interesting to think about it fractally. Thank you. these are the beginnings. You see, it starts with this very, very quiet drumbeat that establishes a certain repetition. And then it kind of, I mean, we don't have time to go through all of it, but eventually it adds up and the fractal kind of grows, and then you get well, you see that it's the same thing. It's the exactly the same that we encountered in the very beginning. Okay, so look, we're not here doing musicology, and I'm not really qualified to talk to you about it. But I just want you to notice how one way to talk about this piece of music is as a fractal, as something that begins as one single phrase that keeps envelopes itself in more and more sound, but essentially it's being self-replicating. You can go to the very last part where all the orchestra is involved with all the instruments and hear exactly the same phrase that is there present in the single drum that just establishes the first notes. Perhaps that's why it is the bolero. Perhaps that's what makes it this really famous piece of music. Maybe something there is something about its fractal nature that goes some way to explain why it is so incredibly popular. I don't know. I'm not saying that that is the case, but I think that perhaps there is a connection. Perhaps we have a kind of, maybe we are drawn to fractals without our even being able to understand it or acknowledge it. There is nothing in our built environment reminds us of fractals very much, you know. So what fractals allow us to do? Well, first, they allow us to look at the everyday and see the fractals there. So for instance, your jumper might be fractal. But even though, even this sort of boxes here, the brick wall, the wood behind you, if you just look at the wood.
Also, we.
We?
Yeah.
Yes, because of course. Of why?
Because we are made of cells.
We are made of cells.
And also because every one of us are equal.
I'm not sure about that. But
arms, head, eyes, and also I have. Maybe not.
Okay. Well, that's very good. Perhaps human society. Perhaps human society is fractal.
Perhaps
social relations are fractal. Now, Max, was it you talking about the lungs? Yeah? So, look at that. Do you see the fractal? It is, in a sense. Isn't it a little bit like Hokusai's wave? No? You don't recognize?
Wow.
Okay.
There is a need.
Look at that. Don't you see the fractal in the veins, in the blood vessels of the lungs?
Yeah?
So here we have sort of the central pipe, and then it will break it down to these tiny shapes, and in a sense, each one repeats and self-replicates all the others. Now, couldn't we also say that human society, or let's say human habitats, or human settlements are fractal? Yeah? Couldn't we then, in a sense, what it suggests to us is to shift our focus from individuals to multiplicities. From looking at us here What would it mean to think about this space, the seminar space, as a fractal then?
I was going to mention there's an artist, like, I'm pretty sure that there might be more than one person doing this, but what they do is they send electricity through acrylic, and then it lets them freeze, like, basically the way that the electricity is trying to reach for the ground. It might be worth looking at because it looks exactly like this. And
Do they have a name?
Well, you can just type, like, lightning through acrylic or something. But in this essay, they actually talk about, like, lightning specifically being a fractal, and about their connection there. Yeah, it looks like that.
Nice.
So they just basically take like a million volts. It's some like crazy amount that they have to charge up to actually make the electricity jump through the acrylic block. And then they take a massive block of acrylic and then put like a ground plate under it. And then just like shove the conductor in the top of the acrylic, and then it creates like this passive, yeah, that.
Very interesting. If you are interested in that, it reminds me of something that is known as Kirlian photography. You familiar with that?
Kirlian.
Kirlian. It's after a Russian engineer. Kirlian photography. It's photography that records halos created by objects when you pass electric shocks through them. Let's say if you have a leaf on photographic paper in the darkroom and you electrocute it, you pass electric shocks through it, then it will record a certain aura. Now, there were various claims that they have some kind of, that this is really the aura and things like that, but it's quite interesting, and it's actually possible to do without massive, very much. It doesn't require powerful energy.
Quite similar.
Which one?
The one that, I don't know the name of the work, but he basically do photograms with electric shock.
Ah, interesting. Well, I don't think they're here. Yeah, that's something like that. Yes?
Yeah.
Okay, well, that allows us. Do you know the work of Hiroshi Sugimoto?
Mm-hmm.
Now, so that allows us to maybe move on to talking about photography and fractals. Because I'm not suggesting that you will start incorporating the classic fractal or Mandelbrot sets or Julia sets in your work. It's not so much the point. The point is to start thinking about how you can harness the power of fractality in your work. Fractality means a couple of things. First, it means that there doesn't need to be a starting point or an end point. It's only the process of self-duplication. It also means that the big and the small are meaningless. The big is the small. The small is the big. Now, Maria, you spoke earlier about Alice in Wonderland. Perfect example. Alice in Wonderland is entirely fractal story. What is happening to Alice when she falls down the rabbit hole? Anyone here is not familiar with Alice in Wonderland? Do you know the story?
It's big and small at the same
time. Yeah. Well, it's...
She eats the...
There is a bottle on the table that says, or a cookie that says, eat me or drink me. Yeah?
It says drink me. And yeah, she eats fools, kind of fools. And she became bigger and then and smaller at the same time.
No,
a part
makes
her bigger, a part
makes
smaller.
Yeah, one bite makes you bigger, one bite makes you smaller, but the whole notion
she
of...
gets bigger. But when you became bigger and smaller, she lived in a different way.
So she approached nature in a different way, because when she's very small, she speaks with the little animals, but they are so much bigger than her, and she's scared by them. And then she become bigger, and she discovered that the little animals were little, but when she was little, she has another view. So this biggest and small make you discover other perspective.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it's practical. You can never see some elements if you put yourself in another. Okay.
And if someone asks, you know, how is it possible to be big and small at the same time? Is it possible to be big and small at the same time? It is possible if you use fractal logic. It is not possible in Euclidean, geometrical, traditional logic. Now, the whole difference is that traditional Euclidean logic...
Yes.
How does it relate to Blake's, like, the grain of sand? You know, the whole world being reflected
to the greatest. Interesting. Well, I think it relates in some way, on some level, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So, this is Euclidean geometry. Just so we are on the same page, Euclidean geometry, yeah, Euclid was a Greek mathematician, 5th century BC, around the same time of Plato, yeah, so you have a mental picture when it happens. And at this moment in the history of Greece, something happened. People somehow, the whole thinking shifted about 500 years BC. So it says now we are in 2000, yeah? So 2,500 years ago, something happened to the thinking, to the way people used to think. And there are various ways to discuss it, but one of them is that it's really clearly demonstrated in these kind of images. It is a geometry which is based, which begins from some fixed axioms, and then erects a whole body of knowledge based on perfect forms. And this is the key. These perfect forms are triangles, circles, parabolas, straight lines, curved lines. The point is that they are all mathematically calculable. In a sense, you could say, from this point onwards, Western science takes mathematics as its foundation. Everything in science, then, and not only in science, everything in thinking becomes grounded in mathematics. So, what Mandelbrot is saying is that, guess what, this as sophisticated and profound this thing is, and have you all done geometry in school?
Yeah.
And it wasn't Euclidean geometry. Yeah, well, I remember it very well, because it was both really beautiful and kind of very hard as well, at least for me it was hard. It was also quite marvelous how it really began from very, very simple ground rules. And then you could develop incredibly complex thinking based on that. But what Mandelbrot is saying, he says, guess what? This way of thinking geometrically is not really capable of grasping the world as it is. So we went ahead, us. And we started to build a Euclidean universe. Our streets are straight, our houses are square, you know, our plazas are circular. We really started to build a world based on Euclidean geometry. But the natural world is nothing like that. And that's Mandelbrot's basic observation. The non-human world, or non-Western human world, you know, is not made of straight lines and perfect triangles and squares. It is made of self-replicating, imperfect, mostly round shapes.
But in the most part, it's like all simulation, all the fractology?
Yes.
So it's only one sense.
Why do you say they follow the fractology?
Because you have like the old set and then built around and then like London, like you don't have the center.
Yeah.
You have like different villages with their centers, which kind of.
Well, I think you're right. I think, you know, you can look at London as a fractal formation, and yet, and which is absolutely true, but somehow it feels that this fractal formation just happened, while what you could do consciously is to build squares and blocks and triangles and circles. Yeah, and yet the fractal seems always to be there.
The golden section,
yeah,
is also reflects the style within nature.
It does a little bit, and also the Fibonacci. Is it Fibonacci? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The Fibonacci curve and the golden mean. Because there was time before Euclid, let's say they went in Pythagorean mathematics, when mathematicians were much more comfortable with the idea of the paradox, with the idea of some kind of harmony. And I think there are some close connections between the Fibonacci sequence and the fractal. That's why I said Mandelbrot really summarized and developed ways of thinking that existed for many hundreds of years, but they were also somehow, they were never accepted as the mainstream of mathematics. They were generally considered monstrosities. It only really since computers made massive calculations possible that fractals became, well, acquired a kind of significance. But what, yes?
Just earlier you said that in architecture, that our architecture is based on Euclidean geometry.
Yeah.
But that's true for Western architecture.
Yes.
But in Islamic architecture, for instance, there is ornamentation that is more based on this idea of self-similarity.
Completely true. I think I did say that it's Western. You're absolutely right. And arabesques, as the example of Muslim art.
But that is because they're not allowed to show people, for one.
Well, I don't know exactly why that is, but I mean, it's true. It's true that Muslim art is non-representational, but so is, for instance, Aboriginal art.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, who said that they were not allowed to show people? Marianne. Yeah. Don't go away. Let's develop this for a second. Maybe really, the reason we could almost say is fractals happen when you are not representing. Perhaps, you're right, but maybe. It is interesting. Perhaps, if there is nothing to stop you from drawing realistic figures, then you could just go and draw people, horses, cows, dogs, flowers. But once someone comes and says, don't do that, then maybe somehow the fractal appears almost naturally. Maybe the fractal is what happens when you don't do representation. Is that feasible? Is that interesting? It might be interesting because also, you know, in the Jewish visual art, which and Jewish art is all traditional Jewish art is also non-figurative because there is a ban on graven images in the Bible. It is also quite fractal in its in its approach. For instance, if you look at the Kabbalistic images, which you will also find very angular.
There is Warburg.
Warburg Archive. AB Warburg.
It's very Fractalic.
Correct, very good. Yes. Anyone knows AB Warburg? Abi Warburg was a German Jewish, archivist, collector, and he developed an approach to building photographic archives. He's very interesting. Why do you think of that as Fractal, Maria? Do you want to tell us?
Finding the name of the work,
There is
this particular work which is very Fractalic, but I'm not happy.
The Mnemosyne.
Elliptical skylight.
Elliptical
skylight. Is not got what I see.
Well, we need to add his name to that.
It's from Warburg.
1926. Is that it?
No. I can pass. Is this one you can see?
Do you get it? Can you see anything?
No.
Is that
painting?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just a dot.
Maria, most of these drawings you have here, they're all fractal. Now, where are we going with this? And why are we spending a day talking about fractals? For two reasons. First, fractals are absolutely essential. If you want to start working with new media, you need to understand fractals. For instance, some of our second year students do a group piece for the degree show in which they work with Twitter and with Raspberry Pi. And it's Neil, Will, and
100?
Yeah. And what they're doing is that they're basically building a fractal environment in which when an image is uploaded with a certain hashtag, they take the top left pixel from each image until they compose their own image, and it gets uploaded back to Twitter or to Snapchat. And so they make this fractal logic work for them as this endless engine of creating images. So that actually allows us to move to asking, what is fractal about photography? Or is photography fractal? Or maybe even we can ask about art in general, but is photography fractal? And if so, in what way? What is fractal about photography?
Yeah.
Oh. Anyone here knows what a film strip looks like? Anyone here has a film strip? So a film strip is, let's say, 36 images in a line. Yeah, you can. Okay, and you can. There was something I had to tell you, but. So after we finish this session and the camera is switched off, I need to tell you something. You reminded me. Okay, so hold your breath. Now, what is this?
Mobius strip.
Mobius strip. Mobius band. what I'm suggesting here, can you think of the film strip as a Mobius band?
What is a Mobius band?
What is a Mobius band? This is a Mobius band.
Yeah, but what is it?
What is it? What is the point of it? Anyone here has...
It only has one surface.
Yes.
One extendedly continuous surface.
That's a bit too small. But then it will be very hard to see. The point of the Mobius band is that it's a very simple thing. It is basically a piece of paper.
Which is Summer's tutorial report.
It's a piece of paper that... Okay, well, then give me a piece of paper now. I need your tutorial reports. All your tutorial reports are mine.
For what? For that.
Exactly. To make more. So, if you join a strip of paper like this, you just get a circle. So then let's say, if you were born on the outside, you will spend all your life going on the outside, all your life going on the outside. You will never go to the inside, because to go to the inside, you somehow need to find a way to either to bore a hole or to go across the edge, and it just not going to work. The Mobius band, it's simply the same strip with a twist in the middle, and this is it. Yeah. So now, if you are born on the outside, and you just keep going in a straight line, suddenly you are inside. You didn't cross any borders, you didn't bore any holes, you are on the inside. You keep going on the inside and you are on the outside. So what does it mean? It means that there is no inside and outside. The inside and the outside is the same size. We suddenly overcome the binary opposition between the inside and the outside. Yeah? All the blue people live on the outside, all the red live on the inside. They've been all the time fighting who is better, like in Gulliver or something. And that was this world of binaries. You know, you are either with us or against us, you are the inside or outside. Suddenly, when we are in the Mobius strip environment, there is no question anymore of the inside and the outside. You can't be, you are both on the inside and the outside. And you never need to cross an edge to move from inside to the outside. Does it make sense? Now, does it make sense?
Yes.
Okay. What is then, well, it's a provocation more than anything else, but think about your photographic strip, your strip of negatives. So normally, you look at it as something like this. Each frame is an image. You can go and make them into pictures. Okay, what will happen if you will do this to it? Or how can you do this thing to it? I don't mean literally. I don't suggest that you literally bend your film like that. But is it possible to think about your photography not in this way, with the inside and the outside, with a model and a copy? This is the world, and this is a picture of the world. This is me when I was 12, you know, and this is my mother in her wedding dress. And it all relates to this one side, the other, on one side there is the world, on the other the image. This, the binary opposition between the image and the thing, the model and the copy, this analogical position that we discussed many times.
In some way, the cosmological photography beast. That because we cannot go in planets, no? We have knowledge of the cosmos only through images, and we cannot go there, no? Okay, it's very rare, we can, but no. The knowledge is transferred by images.
Yes.
While images usually picture, if I take a picture of a person, I can go to the person, I can go in the landscape,
but I can't go on Mars or see Mars how I can see Mars in images. So could be a kind of breaking this opposition between like the thing and the image of the thing.
I like where you are going with it. Hold on to the cosmos, because we're going to talk about it in a second. Let's just go back to this for a moment. So now, I'm offering it to you a bit like Alice in Wonderland. Yeah, it is this Alice in Wonderland moment. I just want to try to suggest that perhaps it is possible. What will happen if we will do that to our photography?
It will become horizon.
My job is done. Yes, it will become a horizon. Now tell us why.
Because it's the same thing as a fractal. Fractal.
Okay. Okay.
Without any main source, without making a difference between inside and outside.
You could, because photography is a capturing of time.
Yeah.
And if you make a Mobius strip out of photography, all time is essentially the same time, compressed into one moment.
Very good. Yes. So this is the question, you know, how to make a Mobius strip out of your film strip. Yeah. And I'm not suggesting to actually twist a piece of film on this, even though why not? But I'm more suggesting to think about it conceptually. Because when we think conceptually about what this allows us to do, this allows us to be on the one side or on the other side. You either the model in front of the camera or you are the photographer behind the camera. It seems to me that if you are thinking about photography like this, you are both at once. You are both the model and the photographer. That you are in every picture you take, and every picture is you. Because the distinction disappears. There is no binary anymore between is it an image of a thing or is it a thing? There is no binary. The thing and the image are the same. So this is the kind of photography I think you are doing. I think you are already surfing the Mobius strip or floating on it. This is just a kind of vocabulary you can use and perhaps a more focused way of thinking about your practice as really going beyond this into something of that kind. Now, I think there are plenty of examples of photographers or artists who work in that way, and I will show you a couple. This to me is one of the most fascinating objects. You know, I always try to keep a Mobius band somewhere on my desk, even in this kind of form, because it tells us something very profound about the way our normal distinctions between opposites can be so easily abandoned. Yeah. Here you can say this is the black and this is the white, and never the two shall meet. But if you do it like that, then the black is becoming white, and the white is all the time becoming black, because the inside is in the process of becoming the outside, and the outside is in the process of becoming the inside. And all there is this state of becoming. So, what does it mean now to be a viewer when we are in this fractal online environment? So, for instance, I view a picture online, for instance, my Facebook stream. I like it. Perhaps I comment on it. I'm already not a viewer. I already contributed something to this image, and my interaction with it will change the way it is algorithmically positioned. So if many people like the same image, it appears much more often in the various streams, and it has various social effects that would otherwise. So in a sense, my comments on this image are not just a comment on the image, they are far-reaching social interventions. When 2 million people like a picture of a video of someone jumping up and down in a chicken suit, in a sort of chicken outfit, that becomes an online sensation. You know, it makes someone's fortune. It gives someone, something to write about. It makes a PhD dissertation. It has real effects in the world. Yeah. So you, as a viewer, you are also the creator of the image, and perhaps the person who actually took the picture in the first place is only one in the chain of these fractal developments that the image is going through. Yeah. So yeah, you're right. There is in the Mobius band, and my argument is that the Mobius band is a fractal, and we are living in this Mobius universe. It's just that we keep trying to understand it in a Euclidean way, and we all the time get somehow poor results because we keep thinking. In a linear Euclidean way, we keep thinking it is like that without realizing that it is this kind of thing. Now, so there's no need to talk, there is no need to think about these distinctions between artist and audience, but more about the way they can be like this. So for instance, you know, in your install, in your performance, you really make quite clear distinction. You wanted it to be very clearly defined. Where is the performance space? Where is the audience space? But you could also think about it in a more Mobius approach and say, well, perhaps I will perform in the middle of the audience or something like that, yeah? So,
there's a sort of like, I don't know, you mentioning like the whole idea of there is no artist and audience, sort of the way like Joseph Beuys did with where he brought like, you know, the talks and the lectures out into like these open spaces and everyone gathered in circles instead of like the way that lectures are normally given. And he was saying everyone is an artist, everyone can be part of this. There is no audience, there is
also
no audience.
There is never art without audience, never.
Yeah, exactly, because it's actually the audience that makes the artwork. No?
Why?
Why?
Because I said the most interesting thing, one of the graduation classes on the Royal Academy of Open Meeting, and I was like walking around, and I heard this voice, and I come by, and there's this woman, and she's sitting all by herself and reading something. And it's like, I'm kind of looking for the audience because you always.
You're the audience.
You're the audience. You're the and then I left, and she continued. I could hear her like that. And she just sat there and read. I thought it was cool.
You're still the audience, though.
But you're the audience.
Yeah, and then I was not. You know, at some point I was out of whatever it's called, and I couldn't hear her anymore. And but she was still doing her thing.
But you wouldn't be able to tell us about it unless at some point you were the audience.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. And one second, we will come back to this.
In a scenario like that, or even when anybody's creating art, while you're creating it and your whole process itself, you are the audience, right? You are making it, but you're also the audience at the same time. There's no binary sort of definition of saying who the artist is and who the audience is.
What is the question?
No, I was just.
Sorry.
Because if, I don't know, maybe like everyone of you like had this thought before, that you know that I don't understand why some artists, like the artists, are not even interested, like getting like real high, and then if you think about it, step to like modern street logic, and then we see like these networks and like all this like communication capital someone might have, and like all the procedures of art market. It makes sense, so I don't know if it's kind of this way of thinking helps me to understand
that
art. How? That it's not about like I'm making art, it's not the making of artists. It's all about the making.
It's not the making of the art.
It's not the making of the art.
What is it then?
Being in this apparatus, like being like the house is surfing through the apparatus, not like following one step after another, but like having, you know, like snakes and leathers.
Yeah. Does it make sense? What Sasha is saying? Sasha is saying that, I never thought about it this way, but I think it's quite brilliant, that this helps to understand how the art market operates. We had a student last year, Aldena, she graduated. She was an investor in the stock market. And all throughout the course, she used to trade in gold. That was her thing. And she spent the nights buying futures in gold. And suddenly she would just come shaking like a leaf because she would have like, you know, many people's fortunes staked on something, and she would just check her phone throughout the session. But she was saying that this way of thinking really helped her to make a lot of money on the stock exchange. Which I never thought that these classes will do. But here we go, she also made that her degree showpiece. How reading Deleuze and understanding how the horizon works, understanding how the Mobius band works, helped her to kind of ride the stock market. And I think you speak about something quite similar, that it's so in the art world, you are saying, it's not so much about what painting you make. If you need to keep trying to make the best painting you like, or you can do, it's more about how you understand the flows of energy within the art market, and in what way you learn how to surf them.
Because very often people ask, you know, like, you're creating, you tell us, this is good art or this is bad art. The question is not relevant in a sense.
Yeah.
Because it's different logical.
The question is not whether it's good art or bad art. The question is what rhythms it can connect with.
So it should serve somehow.
You want to say something? Mm-hmm. Ah. You were holding a pen and just
wait.
Yeah. That's okay. But does it make sense the way Sasha? So you say in a sense, it kind of says, it's not so much what you paint. It's more how what you paint and the openings you go to and the people you speak to and the magazines you read, the blog posts you publish, how it all somehow connects, because there is no inside and outside. It's not like on the inside you make the art, on the outside it, you know, it gets, it's both ways somehow. But it's all...
I think it's quite a plant to follow the rhythm of art market.
Yeah, I agree. It's not that I'm agreeing. I think you are right, but it's not the point. It's not the question whether it is a good thing to do or not. It just, this is the logic of the art market. The logic of the art market is not about making the best painting. It's about somehow plugging into a certain flow.
It's the zeitgeist.
I'm not sure that it is the zeitgeist. Zeitgeist means the spirit of the moment. But you could be connected to the spirit of the moment. You can make images which are very much of the moment, and yet people will not exhibit them.
And they can be different from the art market, but in the spirit of the moment, maybe.
So, but I think the point I want to say, and you're right, Maria, to remind us, there is nothing inherently better about the Mobius logic. It's not more morally pure. It's not more ethical. It's not better or good in any way. It's just a logic. Like any logic, you can use it for good purposes, you can use it for bad purposes. The Deleuze's logic of the rhizome, you know who is using it to very good effect, good in inverted commas? The Israeli military. They'll tell you about it. Should I tell you about it now? Yeah, so Eyal Weizmann, he has a center for forensic architecture in Goldsmith. He wrote a book about it. That was his first book. So I'm acknowledging his contribution to this way of thinking. He showed how the Israeli military, when it during the second Intifada, the Intifada is the popular popular Palestinian uprising against Israeli occupation. So you showed how during the Intifada, the second one, which was very bloody and involved Israeli army entering the Palestinian towns and refugee camps, such as Jenin, a very famous refugee camp, in order to avoid being hit by the snipers, the Palestinian snipers who were placed, let's say, in some strategic points, they had to find a way of somehow going through the city without actually being on the streets, because on the streets you can get hit. So what they done, they applied a kind of rhizomatic thinking. They said, well, we don't need to think about in this way, this is the street and this is the house. You know, you can only go on the street. So what if we do it like that? What if people say that the street is the house? The house is the street. That means that as you approach the town, you enter into the first house on the first street, handcuff all the occupants, detonate the wall between this house and the next one, move into the next house, all through the house, handcuff the inhabitants, rinse, repeat. And that's how you bore tunnels, essentially, through the houses, getting where you need, without at any point being on the street where you can be exposed. So this is the modus, yeah, because it's not, you know, here you can go, here you cannot go. This is a wall, this is a street. Guess what? A wall can be a street, you just make a hole through it. Yeah, so just to say, to answer Marina's question, nothing is inherently human or positive or good in the mobius. It's just a way of thinking. Yeah, you can do whatever you like with it. It's just energy. It's a bit like Hollywood. You know, Hollywood can make amazing films and can make rubbish films. You know, so I don't think that Hollywood is evil simply because, you know, it's energy. It can make the Titanic, which is a terrible film, and it can make a film like Memento, which is on some level a terrible film, on some level a deeply interesting film that allows you to think very differently about time, about memory. Did you see Memento?
It's on yeah.
So you see, it's a force. What you do with the force is a question, but forces are not good or bad. Forces, they're just force, you know? What the force wants is to expand and to create and to make. So what is, the last 10 minutes, what is the photographic Mobius band? What is the Mobius band of your own practice? Last week in the photographer's gallery, I offered this image for contemplation, which you saw already, so let's just look at it again. The Bechers, yeah? Now, is it the Mobius band? Why?
Why?
Yeah. I thought you said it.
No, I was those you.
Okay. Okay. Why is that the Mobius band?
Because there's no starting point to this, like, spherical object, and there's no starting point. Like, you can't choose one of the frames and say this is the first frame, this is the last frame. You can start at any point and keep going with it.
Very good. Yeah, I think that's right. So you can look at it as a Mobius map. Yeah. Why? Because it seems to harness the power of repetition and self-replication. Okay. Is it a fractal? Is it a fractal?
Yes.
Why?
Because it's the same thing.
It's the same thing repeating itself. It's like the broccoli. It is the same thing repeating itself. Now, it's interesting though, because we've been looking at the Bechers for many years. You know, you probably know their work for at least 10 years, 20 years. Suddenly, we have another way of looking at something very familiar and seeing it in a different light. This is a fractal because it is the same shape repeating itself each time there is something slightly different happening, yeah? So there is this similarity and dissimilarity. Which one is the most accurate? Which one is the most realistic? Kind of, it's not the right question. What matters is repetition. And what repetition creates? Repetition creates a rhythm. Can you feel here the rhythm? But this is the rhythm of the gas silos. But at the same time, there is another rhythm. Where is it? Where is it?
In a difference.
In the differences between them, yeah? So now, can someone tap this rhythm? What that will sound like? There is something else. So can someone do that? No?
I was gonna say that I was having this discussion with somebody the other day. What was the difference between synchronization and syncopation?
Yes.
And as it turns out, syncopation is the spacing in between the beats, whereas synchronization is the beats. So it's
That's lovely. That's
in
lovely.
Essence, it's exactly the same.
That's very nice.
It's like a rhythm within there not being without like the presence of rhythm.
Great, yeah. So, for instance, this space here, if you just focus your attention on this space here, can you see? This space here is defined. It's only happening because of these images. You take them away and it disappears. So it's only there for as long as there is representation. And yet, this space, what it is representative of? It doesn't represent anything. This might represent a real gas silo. This might represent a real gas silo. What this space represents? Yes? It represents what? It doesn't represent anything. It is something. What it is?
Sub-repetition.
Exactly. This is the repetition. The space is also a repetition, but it is also something. It's not a representation of something. It is difference. Difference in itself. Yeah? Now, that is quite interesting because it appears that we capture photographically something that is nothing that is not representation, which is the difference between representations. In order for these representations, for all these images to exist, they have to be kind of submerged into some difference. In a sense, before you can talk about these separate representations or images, there has to be a kind of difference. And it sort of emerges in between the spaces. So this difference is not a representation of anything. It is simply the thing itself. It is the is. This is quite difficult, you know? It's difficult because it's so simple. Because this difference makes you what you are and why you are not the next person. Yeah, this difference is all around us. In a sense, it was there before us, yet we keep somehow forgetting about it, but it is made possible through representation. And I finished the talk last week, yesterday, the photographer's gallery, through with this image, which is from Google Street View, where you see, that's what happens when you just Google the Beckers and you get these images. So, is that a rising? is etherizing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, you see, the Google search engine is a riser. The Google search algorithm is a riser. Yeah? Why is it a riser? Because there is no point in asking which one of these is the more accurate representation of the original vectors. Is that more original, or that more original, or that more original? The question of the original becomes irrelevant. What is relevant is that there is this infinite repetition, infinite because you can scroll down more and more and more and have lots of other versions of the same thing. So, do you see, this is a riser. So it's interesting, I want you to make space in your practice for this realization that the riser, the dominant figure of contemporary visual practice, contemporary art. That's how things are done, yeah? So that means, for instance, that Vinicius. I was thinking about your install on Monday, because you had this really beautiful Instagram of this one painting of the mountain. Now, what would happen if you would think of it as a rhizome? You know, because it seems that Cezanne?
Mm-hmm.
He thought about his painting as a rhizome, because he made 100 paintings of the mountain. Yeah? So, while maybe his logic was not rhizomatic, he was more interested in the way there is no original, there are only versions. In a sense, this is very rhizomatic thinking. Perhaps what your project now needs is something like that. Yeah. What was the name of the painting, by the way?
The Mont Saint Victor.
Yeah. So here we have the rising of that painting. So this is why, you know, we don't want to think in terms of individuals, but we do want to think in terms of singularities. What is a singularity? Singularities relate to universals. They are universals and they are singularities. Can I have another sheet of paper? No? Thank you. Now, this is a square. Does it have any singularities?
The little square is a square.
No.
Why?
The singularities are here. Why are they here? These are points where something is changing. These are points which are outside of the general rule of the infinite number of points. Yeah? These are the points of intensity, change of direction. Something breaks.
And also the points, the squares within the square and not where those outside the lines.
Where, which ones?
Those inside are limited by the lines.
But I'm only talking about the lines.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Here is another example of a singularity, and it's from Leibniz.
Ah, okay. I slightly miscalculated. Okay. So, can you see? So basically, they're supposed to touch here. Well, if you want to do it better than me, please. Well, that's pretty nice. That's bring back bad memories.
It all makes sense on Monday.
Sorry?
It all makes sense on Monday.
On Monday? Why? What is on Monday?
Her install.
Your install. Ah, okay, good. So, what is a singularity? Now, you see, this is a parabola, A to B. Yeah? This is another parabola, A1 to B1. Now, each point on the parabola, on the A to B parabola can be reflected in the one underneath. Yeah? Each point is symmetrically related. The only point that is singular is this point where the two touch each other. Yeah? And if you draw a horizontal line so that you could see, you could say these are universals and this is a singularity. Now people sometimes use singularity as a moment where computer processing power becomes, you know. And that's not the one we're talking about. We talk about here about the various notions you can use for your art practice. So one of them, don't think about individuals. So don't think about individuals, think about repetition. Don't think about individual frames on the negative. Think about the Möbius band, the negative strip can become. Don't think about yourself as an individual artist making work for the audience. Think about the process that involves various actors that all together create something along the way. Call it what you like. Think in terms of intensities. Here is a point of intensity where something changes, yeah? But these points of intensity are also fractal. They also repeat themselves. So, you know, we didn't really go that far from the Deleuze Guattari Thousand Plateaus. We just, over the last couple of weeks, we're trying to introduce some new dimensions into their way of thinking. So, that was the very sketchy introduction to fractals. As I said, I think you are already working with fractals. You kind of cannot help it. Online environment is fractal. Your life is fractal, you know? Your life is sort of, it's made of zigzags, you know, of segments. I would also like very much to talk to you about, we're running out of time, so maybe another 2 minutes and then we finish. What happens when you upload an image online? You take a picture, then you put it online. It doesn't have any place where it is. It can be anywhere. And everywhere, it can be also modified and acquire new meanings. So in a sense, the picture you upload, even if it's a picture of your cat, on some level has the potential to become undecidable, to become something else. It can be morphed, it can be modified, it can be someone might edit to a collection of cat pictures, someone might edit to a collection of pictures that were all made on a certain day. Someone might look at it as belonging to a completely different series. What the picture is of, what is the actual content, is not so important. What is more important is in what sequence, in what rhythm you insert this image. And in the rhythm, in the sequence, it will acquire a different meaning. So what does it mean, for instance, to someone who wants to work politically, like you, she wants? You know?
Hello?
Perhaps, again, maybe, let's say, revisiting the video that you showed a couple of weeks ago, how will it work as a fractal? How will it work as a multiplicity? how does it work in terms of repetition? Because in a sense, the, what you are talking about, even whether it is exploitation, whether it is abuse, they are never individual events. They are always repeated. So it, maybe it is the repetition that actually needs to be explored, more than what happened in this point in time, or in this point in time, what is more relevant, maybe even more painful, is that it's not this point or that point or that point, but it is the continuous chain of events. That it's the chain of events that constitutes the somehow the event of abuse or exploitation or inequality or unfairness. Yeah, it's a sequence. Even that is a kind of fractal. So perhaps reflecting on that also requires a fractal approach. So we just been investigating a way of stepping away from individuality, our own, that of the viewer, that of the artwork, in favor of rhythms that have no beginning, no end. Thank you very much. Good night.